own story in terms of our spirituality and our spiritual practices and our positioning in the world. And one of my spiritual lineages is Mami Wata. I am a priestess of Mami Wata. She's been with me since I was born. One of my earliest dreams were of being underneath water, as if I'd been plunged into water and I could see the sun, and I was always trying to look towards the sun, trying to grab the sun, trying to get out of the water, but I'd be consumed by the water. Since going back to the motherland, I've also had that confirmed, and she's also communicates a lot with me. How I got into African spirituality was not through anyone initiating me or teaching me anything. The ancestors came to me themselves and showed me things that I shouldn't have known, and initiated me in ways that could only be done by them. And when I realized, how our energy works, especially as a Black woman, I understand now why I had to go through that journey of remembering. Anyway, in order for me to put together the pieces, the missing pieces of her story, I had to go looking for it in all of these hidden places, right? And we have seen how Christianity has been basically used as a way of, has been spread, let's say spread, the whole way around the world by a group of people who have changed the discourse of what it actually meant. They have changed and plagiarized the energy of the information that was presented, and used it as a way of demonizing the culture of others and suppressing a whole community of people, and then essentially trying to suppress the world with it. When you look at the symbology that's associated with the Western Christianity of the cross represents, well, the cross with a man dying on it, that represents a death of consciousness. When you see the Christ, Christ represents your consciousness, your higher self. So why are we given this image of the self being, the higher self basically being crucified? It's showing you the consciousness, your consciousness being crucified, that it's a dead consciousness. When we look at ancient Kemet and we look at the symbology there, and we look at the caduceus, and we look at the symbol which has the staff with the two serpents which represent your kundalini energy, your masculine and feminine energy, then you have at the top of the staff, you have the ball which represents the mind, which represents your head, your God connection, and then you have the wings which represents your angelic self, your illumination, your enlightenment, your divine self. You will see how these two symbols look so similar, the cross and the caduceus, which they then, you know, likened to or connected to Hermes with their Greek philosophy. One represents the illumination of your consciousness. Like the serpent, as much as you were taught that it was a symbol of negativity and evil, actually represents elevation, enlightenment of your consciousness. Your kundalini energy sits within your root chakra. And I've seen it as two serpents now. I see two serpents. One serpent that is in the crown, in the medulla oblongata. And then you have another serpent which is in your root chakra. And those two serpents come together and make that energy, that kundalini energy, that raises your divine consciousness. When you look at our ancient Kemetic priests and priestesses and kings, they would have the uraeus, which is basically the serpent head, the cobra head, coming out of their crowns, right? That represented the elevation of their divinity. It represented their mastery, you know, the mastering of the 33 degrees, which are the 33 vertebrae in your spine. So the degrees that you're going up in terms of the spine is the degrees that it takes to receive, to embody your God consciousness, to embody your God self. The Ark of the Covenant is within your own crown. It's within your own body, your own being, right? So they've taken this information and made it seem like it's all fairy-like and kind of out there and dominated by a certain group of people and a certain class of people, mainly to control and dominate the discourse and the rhetoric, and also to destabilize us, to destabilize and disconnect us from our original story, from our power, from our true understanding of who it is that we are. So part of the research that I've been doing to put this information together is a book called The SYBILS, The First Prophetesses of Mami Wata. And I read this book a little while ago at first, but then I reread it last year. And it just blew my mind in terms of the evidence and information that it was able to provide to justify and support the truth of what's happened to the plagiarization of her story, the plagiarization of not just the Black woman, but Black people's in general contribution to this reality that we live in, and especially the spiritual systems and the spirituality. So in the workshop that I'm going to be doing this Saturday, I'm going to be presenting more information about the hidden divine feminine, the hidden the hidden creator, the black woman, the hidden creator. And as I said, this is not about exalting the black woman as if she is something beyond, you know, everything else. No, I'm not doing that. But I'm just acknowledging that the woman, you know, when you teach a woman, when you heal a woman, she can teach and heal her child and then teach and heal her nation. And we have to understand our positioning. We have to understand our masculine and feminine energy so that we know how they work together. In ancient Kemet, they understood the divine nature of balance and sacred harmony and masculine and feminine energy working together. They understood that the woman represented the subconscious. She is connection to the creator. She lives and dwells within the hidden realms. That's why a woman's intuition, even if she hasn't activated it, even if she hasn't even spent much time like trying to develop her intuition, she has natural intuition. In Ifa really symbolizes feminine energy. The Odu pot is the womb, right? Oludumari represents the womb, and so you can see that it's a feminine system. But at the same time, the patriarchal influence of it is that women are not able to, participate in the ceremonies in the same way. And I always used to look at it like, you know, why is it that there's always this subjugation of the feminine energy? And what I didn't understand at the time was because of the feminine energy's power. We are connected fully as we are born with what's called Aje, not Ashe, Aje, right? Which is feminine power. It's spiritual power. This is something that we are all born with, right? Whether we activate it or not, our cycles are connected to the cycles of the planet, of the heavens, of the stars, of the moon. You know, our own emotional body center, like, we are the universe. All of the planets are within us. All the cycles and the rhythms and the cosmos are within us. When a black woman is enraged, she's like a tornado. She's like, you know, she can be destructive. When she is in her happiness, she can be radiant. She can be like joy. She makes everything grow. Do you understand what I mean? So it's understanding your innate nature and power and learning how to utilize that energy in the right way, right? So the more I started to investigate this, the more I started to feel like, okay, there is information here that needs to be brought out, that needs to be brought out to people so that they can understand what has taken place. Because for so long, I felt on my spiritual journey as if, my spiritual experience was whitewashed. I'm a natural seer, I'm a natural healer, I'm a natural subconscious specialist, meaning that I live within the womb of spirit. I live in the subconscious realm. When I take people on meditations, I literally guide you through the subconscious. I take you into the womb. I'm not just speaking words and speaking to your mind. I'm taking you on that journey, which is why it's always so deep when I work with my clients, right? Because I'm actually in the experience. I am taking myself and others into the womb, right? And so when we talk about the primordial energies, the cosmic black, when we talk about the black or set, the sophist, you know, all of these things, when you go into these spiritual practices and, you know, these new age groups, you don't see our face there. You don't see our story there. When they talk about Mary Magdalene, you see this white-faced woman with brown hair, and same like you do when you see the Jesus picture, I suppose, which is so out of alignment with the time where they would have lived and history. You can see so much in the history that there are so much blurred lines, things that just don't make any sense. But because it's what we've been given and we've been told that it's truth and that it's fact and it's been shoved down our throats and we've been taught it in school, which conditions us with all of the crap that they want us to believe in order to partake in their foolish reality, which is not real, right? So you have to start searching for yourself. You have to start looking for the hidden information. And that's another reason why you can't just rely on Google, because Google's agenda is to collect information, but that information can be utilized and weaponized in any way, right? And it could also be plagiarized, and it can also be erased. Important information can be erased. So you have to be willing to investigate and look and research. And so when I was beginning this journey, I guess kept on being brought back to Mami Wata, And I knew that part of my journey of this, in this lifetime, was to bring oneness in spirituality, because I had walked on the side where I was now studying my spiritual practices. I was only around Caucasian people. There were only white people there. I studied at the College of Psychic Studies. I studied at the Past Life Regression Academy. All of the institutes that I studied in was mainly Caucasian people. And they knew the power. They knew, you knew who I was. They could see in me, but I couldn't see my own power. I couldn't see my own self. And in a way, I wanted to be... I felt like I needed to be like them to be acceptable. Like, what I knew, how do you know that? How do you do this? You know what I mean? I was very much into rituals because that's how my great-grandmother taught me in spirit. She would tell me, go and get that and put this together and things like that, right? But then in our community, the black community, I started to realize that people looked at me in a certain way. Like, even now, I get a lot of people prejudging me. Oh, you're an idol worshiper, or you're this and you're that. And I'm like, what? Like, my connection with the creator is so finite. Like, I knew the creator before I even knew my own parents. That's how deep it was. Like, I my connection with God was the only thing that I knew. Like, speak to me in my head, that voice in my head, that's God. Like, there is no separation. So when I now started to venture into African spirituality, it wasn't because I was looking for anything or I wanted to this, or my mum was into OBR or anything like that, because my family is from Trinidad. So that Shango Baptist energy, that information is in my DNA, but it's not something that was talked about, you know, or encouraged. My mum didn't tell me, oh, these are the rituals. No, my mum didn't deal with me like that. Yes, there are other people. I know the generation before me were more likely to know certain things, you know, like rituals to keep your man and all these kind of things. But I'm an indigo child. I didn't grow up in that era. Like, so that wasn't me. I actually had a natural disdain for anything that felt like dark energy to me. Because a simple thing for me is, like, I don't want no one to do something to me that stops me from being in control of myself. I don't even want to be with someone who doesn't want to be with me. Like, I'm not going to waste my time and my energy to try and work on using the forces of nature. Do you know how much energy and time that takes to cause harm to somebody? Like, to try and force somebody to be with you. The spiritual lessons, when you master yourself first before using magic and these things as a way of a crux, right, you realize that everything in your life is happening for you. You realize that as a feminine, you have a power of magnetism. When you're in your highest vibration, when you're living in your truth, things magnetize to you, you know? So why are you going to want to be with someone that doesn't want to be with you? If you're in a relationship with someone and they're not with you, there's a lesson that you need to learn. We're here to learn. We're not here to just have what we want. So we fell in our consciousness and started to utilize our energy and our magic and whatever in a way that caused harm for us. And now we're, even as community, we're still having to clear some of that trauma. A lot of the stuff that I'm working with sometimes is clearing some of that stuff from people's family lineages and from their consciousness. But that was not something that I went looking for. It wasn't like, oh, I wanted to go and learn how to do rituals on people. No, it never came from that. I was standing on the stage and I was singing, and whilst I was singing, I could hear this voice in my head saying, Yemaya, Yemaya, the singing. And I was like, oh, and I was part of a group called African Revolution at the time, and there was an elder called Baba, and he was from Nigeria, he was Yoruba, so I didn't know. I just asked him, who's Yemaya? And when I said that to him, he was like, oh, why? And I told him why, and he was like, you are a daughter of Yemaya, she is calling you. And it just reminded me of the dream that I had when I was a child, of me being in the water and trying to get, you know, and water represents worlds. You know, as we come into each world, as we come into each reality, we come through water. So, so I didn't have that experience of growing up and seeing how, you know, the misuse of spiritual practice and OBR and all of these things had toxicated even the women in our communities, right? They were now using their power for things that just didn't make sense to me. You know, why would you want to try and hold a man who doesn't see the value and worth in you? It just made no sense. But this is a direct reflection of the fact that the woman, the black woman, the divine feminine, was also, all of her talents and all of her gifts and were taken away, you know? And so she's left in that victim state, that vulnerable state, that witch state, who wants to control everything because things aren't moving in her favor. And you feel this energy in us a lot. You feel it. So the point I'm trying to make is that it wasn't something that I was looking for, because I had already had this natural resistance to it. Like, I didn't want to be involved in anything that was about controlling people. The energy of it felt very dense. And so I just was like, nah, I'm not feeling this. I'd rather stay in my love and my light and the God that I know, right? God doesn't work like that. So I then ended up meeting somebody who would then be my spiritual teacher who basically introduced me to this world of Black spirituality, African spirituality, and he was initiated in the order of Melchizedek. He was initiated in the Rastafarian order, so he was dealing with Rastafarian spirituality and Rastafarian spirit magic, which is all based on Solomonic orders and symbols and symbologies and all of these things, right? As well as the Obias and the Kotombles and whatever. And through the experience of learning with him, I realized that my gift, my generation, was here to bring change to all of that. It was here to raise the vibration of what had been done with our power. Like, we've been taught to use our power to do parlor tricks. It's literally like that. The gods that we are have now been chained up and shackled, and now we're just doing parlor tricks and, you know, being hags and witches to each other. You know, like, they even fear women in Africa who have spiritual power, especially in Nigeria. They call them Ayami Aje. They call them the witches. Whereas Ayami Aje means the mothers. The mothers of creation. Why did they call them the witches? Because these priestesses had the power to give life, to take away life, to, you know, and that's a lot of power to have. You don't want to upset that person because you think that that person is then going to try and kill your child. So can you see what's happened in the discourse of the woman having power and now this creating fear? Especially because if the woman's not balanced in herself, then yeah, she might decide to smite and attack someone who has done her harm without really coming from her God self. So this is what happened when we fell, right? And so even now as we're awakening, you can see it. You can see there's some of these groups on Facebook are like cesspits for people who are trying to get to a certain level of consciousness in their life and in their experience, but they're just using their gifts in such a low vibrational way to cause harm to each other and steal from each other and all this kind of ridiculous rubbish, like, and that's what's caused us the problems that we're experiencing. You know, we're not using our power to help bring change. We're not using our power for good. We're using it to cause harm against each other. Whatever spell or deception that had us looking against each other and fighting and squabbling, you know, to the end of time, was because we didn't see each other. Because we didn't see the value in each other. We didn't see the power in each other. We started to get jealous of each other. We started to judge each other. And so that's where the real healing needs to take place. Between us, right? So, yeah, that's a little bit about my journey. You know, I've gone on to deepen my knowledge of spirituality. I've gone on to exceed it and excel it, you know, excel the limitations of our ancestors that came before us. And that's what we've come here to do. But you have to go through what it is that they went through. You have to be exposed to the same knowledge in order to transform it. So whilst I was going through our history, picking together all of these pieces to basically understand all of the aspects of me and what it is that I'm here for and what it is that I'm here to do, I stumbled upon this book, as I said, The Sybils, the first prophetesses of Mami Wata. One of my gifts is the prophetess. I speak things into reality. I see things as they are. And so when I started to read this book, it really enlightened me because I'd never seen it written like this before, right? So in my workshop on Saturday, which is called Awakening Her, The Rise of the Black Divine Feminine, which is a free workshop. So as I said, if you want to come to that workshop, put a comment in the box or send me a text on 07-455-617-892. That's 07-455-617-892. In that workshop, I'm going to present all of the information that has helped me to understand where, you know, to put all of those pieces of the story back together, because it's time for us to build and time for us to raise our vibration. But we also need more awakened women. We need more awakened men. We need more gods and kings and queens who are walking around in their magic and majesty. We need more healers. We need more nurturers, and we need more builders. This is what we're going to need to build our future. So we need this information to come back to its rightful place and into our hands so that we can utilize it to build and empower ourselves. Remember what the first card said, we must have grace. You know, we must have grace, even in our ascension. We must have grace because that's the understanding that all is one story. There is no separation, no oppressor. It's like I choose to be on the opposite football team as you today, right? That doesn't mean that we're enemies. It means that we are both co-creating an experience which allows both of us to experience what it is that we need to experience and have fun and have joy. You know what I mean? So we have to understand it from that perspective. Have grace, have understanding, have compassion, but still move. Like, Still walk with your majesty. Still never allow yourself to be a victim again. That's an inside job. You don't have to walk around beating everybody else out on the head about how great you are and how less they are. It's not about that. It is about total oneness and ma'at. So I'm going to read some of this information in the hope that it brings forth some insight. And this is for all people. This is not just for black people. This is for white people. This is world history, people. I said we have to stop separating the history. It is world history. All right? So I'm going to read a snippet of it. I'm going to read the introduction. Yes, I am. So this book is called The SYBILS, The First Prophetess of Mami Wata by Mama Zogbe. So before there was, and this is a, as I said, it's a perception, it's a truth. Whether you choose to acknowledge it, believe it, align with it or not, don't judge me. Your reality is your reality. My reality is my reality. I'm presenting the facts as are. As I said, this is world history. World history. So this is not about separation. It is about oneness. We have to come to the place of oneness. Then we need all the facts, right? Disclaimer. So before there was Jehovah, a minor volcano, fire, thunder deity, elevated as God under Afro-Afrim, which means Jewish patriarchy, there was Mami, Isis, as the preeminent dual goddess and god who dominated the entire ancient world. And I will say this again, the dual goddess and god, because when you look at ancient Kemetic art, you see that Mut, who represents the mother, has both a phallus and breast and wings, representing that dualistic nature of god and goddess within the one flesh. So for more than 6,000 years, nearly all of Africa was matriarchal. The dominant presence of African matriarchy resulted not as a consequence of political, feminist or military usurpation, but rather because it was original and, more importantly, the natural divine order of the African civilized world. Okay? Its cosmology, philosophy, theology, ritual, practices, and rich African culture emphasize the complementary relationship between what has come to be known as masculine and feminine divine energies, as it exists in both nature and within the universe. What passes for traditional African culture today, where women have been subdued and relegated to marginal roles in African political and religious life, is the result of the patriarchal usurpation of the older matriarchal orders, upon which the patriarchs sought to contain and to control her divine powers and political and economic influence. Even I studied that the Marys who supported Jesus, and as I said, these are all stories, right? These women that walked with Jesus, they funded his organization. They were giving him their wealth and their abundance, yeah? They weren't in a position of just being poor women that needed saving. They were the ones that were giving him spiritual food, physical protection, and financial support to his cause. These are things that you can go and research for yourself, all right? So women have always been abundant, naturally abundant. All right. So, however, hidden beneath the patriarchal substratum of modern day Africa, one will discover that it was under African matriarchy which birthed ancient Africa and Mediterranean culture and high civilization. Mediterranean culture as well, right? So even the Babylonians are not separate from us people. They're not separate. And Lil Enki, us. Yep. So the first prophets of Mami were African women. I love that. The first prophets of Mami were African women. They were called Sybils. So you've heard of the Sibylline oracles. Check out the Sibylline oracles and you will see that there is a lot of evidence to suggest that the Sibylline oracles, the information written in the Sibylline oracles, was what was used for the plagiarized Bible, the plagiarized Western Bible, I would like to add, all right? The black Sybils were the black doves. They were the black women. Even in Greek times, even in Roman times, these black women's wisdom was sought. No king or queen, Herodotus and other of these Greek and Roman gods, they sought out the wisdom of the black women before they even went and did anything. How do you think Rome was able to conquer the world? The world. Think about it. Think about it. Keys open doors. Nothing happens without that spiritual energy and power attached to it. Okay, so the first prophets of Mami were African women. They were called SYBILS, meaning that they were Mami Wata priestesses and priests of the Oannes. Their prophecies are the oldest in the world. It is through their divine blood, the divine blood of these SYBIL priestesses, that the patriarchal kingships of the pharaohs, the Hebrew prophets, and the Chaldean priests were born. And remember what I said, it is through the divine blood of these SYBILS. Another reason why women have been vilified is because they are the first blood, the first sacrifice, the first blood. When you are born through a woman's blood, and that woman bleeds every month. That bloodlet represents two things. Number one, it represents the sacrifice of her divine self to split herself, right? So she was one, that's her divinity. She split herself. That's where you get man and woman, right? Male and female, the splitting. When you split, when you separate, you observe. You want to observe yourself. You want to see yourself beyond that which you are. You split in order to observe yourself. So that bleeding is representative of the cut, the wound between the divine goddess, which is masculine and feminine as one, now choosing to live itself in separation, so it can see itself, so it can observe itself. But then the second thing of that is that the blood is the sacrifice. So you see now with all of these other African spiritual traditions where they be sacrificing goats and all these kind of things. Why do you think they do that? The original sacrificial blood is the woman's blood, the menstrual blood. Yeah, you can do your research. It was used as one of the most powerful and protective forces in the world. They would put sacred blood on men who were going to war to empower them, to give them the spirit. Yeah, it's been seen as something that's nasty now. I mean, it's the purest fresh blood. Like when you are clean, it is pure. It's like fresh, powerful life force energy. But you've been taught that it's nasty. And so then you become nasty. You know what I mean? Like, oh, it's just ridiculous. So that's one of the reasons, because of the power of that sacrificial pure blood, right? Pureness from which all things come from, which all things are created from. Every man goes through that blood in order to be born. Okay? Sorry, it's the truth. So we have to start being real. And blood is light. Blood is crystals. When blood dries, you can reflect light through it. When you look at it through a microscope, it has rainbow colors in it. Light. Your blood is light. You are a light being. It's not carbon. It's light, right? So we're giving birth, and that blood is light. That's the gateway, the waters, the primordial waters of Nun. But we've been taught that it's nasty. You know, if you're having a bingy, the woman can't come if she's on her cycle. Why? Because, I mean, I'm not saying this about the bingy specifically, but one thing I will say is the reason why a lot of women were excluded from certain rituals and gatherings was because the males wanted to do their own thing. They wanted to do things that were out of ma'at. They wanted to manifest things that weren't in alignment for what was best for all. They wanted to do it for what was best for them to be in power and them to succeed. A lot of the fights that you see between man and woman is because the males... And this is a story of what happened in Egypt, right? The male priests started to get upset and jealous of the women priestesses because everybody loved the women priestesses. And the male priests were like, hang on a minute, we're not getting that love like how you get the love, you know? And then they started to perform rituals where normally when they would make love in the morning, they would make love and that would spread the energy of divine union to the consciousness of all of the people. That's what the purpose of the priest and the priestess's role was, right? To maintain the frequency and consciousness of the people to make sure that it was in alignment with Ma'at. But what they did now is because the men started to feel like, rah, you know what? Maybe we need some of their feminine energy. We're going to move our energy center. So where we normally connect together in the heart, both of us in the heart, we're going to move our energy center. We're going to place our energy in the phallus, down in the root, so that when she comes to us in the heart, we can extract her energy. And it is said in that story that the angels then came and said to the priestesses, you need to be mindful because there's a deception taking place. And this was the first time that the seat between man and woman came together. The priestess was told of what the plan of the priest was, and so she moved her energy center from her heart, right, into her sacral. So the woman feels everything now, but she's not always connected to her heart. She's not in her heart space. So when they both connected that morning, that rising, on the top of Mount Sinai, they realized that they both duped each other. They realized that they were not, that they had both shifted, and that consciousness now permeated to the people, that man and woman no longer trusted each other. We were no longer meeting each other in the same epicenter. So I'm saying that this is some of the stories that help us to document and understand what took place, right? But there was a need for, there was a separation through deception. Where we were working together in harmony, now it was like, well, no, we don't want you to see what we're doing, because your energy is going to, you know, is going to mess up what it is that we're doing, because what we're doing isn't actually in alignment with Ma'at. But at the end of the day, you know, do as thou wilt. It came out of, let's work in harmony because this is the way, to now do as thou wilt. We can now manipulate Mother Nature, and we can now take this knowledge and energy that we have, and we can become the gods. We don't need the women. We don't need that feminine energy. We can become the gods, and we're stronger than them. And the woman now has, you know, becomes this pious, subjugated, oh, you know, Lilith, which is Lilitu, as I said, Lilitu, not Lilith, because she is our history. And that's what her name was, Lilitu, right? She was demonized. Oh, well, you can't be a woman that speaks up for yourself. Like I tell you, the optimal position for man and woman to make love is not with the woman underneath the man. It is with the woman sitting on the man, because the phallus is erect and connected to the source, and she is the yoni. So now you have a chalice. You have the unk that connects you to the source. So how can it really be any other way? Do you understand what I mean? Like, you're descending your consciousness when you're trying to impregnate a woman and she's under you. So it's like all of this stuff was there to pander to this male patriarchal ego of trying to make themselves feel better about something, which, you know, it's just stupid anyway, because we're all one. We work together in harmony, right? And so this is where the birth of all of this stuff came from. And women now became these dirty creatures who you can't allow into spiritual positions of leadership and all these kind of things, when they are naturally natural nurturers, natural caregivers, natural intuitives, right? I mean, I digress. So I'm going to bring it back to the book. There was a reason why the women were now pushed out of all of the religious practices. And I'm sorry to say that the Moors do have something to do with this as well, because they did subscribe to this particular kind of culture, you know. And yeah, I mean, this is the information that I've researched and I've found, and this is what I've seen. So if you can tell me something different, then that's great. And I'm not using it, I'm not bringing it up to try and separate. I'm just trying to get the truth, so that we're not stuck in any kind of, oh, well, yes, no, you've got to be a more, or you've got to be this, or you've got to be that. No, be yourself, like, be your divine self, because within all these organizations, there's an agenda. And we're coming to a point of releasing all of that. Like, let's just deal with the truth so that we can get to healing, right? So I digress. Let me carry on. So, it is through the divine blood of these Sybils, priestesses, that the patriarchal kingships of the Pharaoh. Greetings, Hazel. Mwah, thank you. I need to speak to you, but the fact that you turned up right now is divinely aligned. Thank you so much. It's through the divine blood of these Sybil priestesses that the patriarchal kingships of the Pharaohs, the Hebrew prophets, and the Chaldean priests were born. It was the Sybil's style of prophecy and magic that would later be limited by a militant faction from these groups, who were envious of her global positioning and rebelled against the divine matriarchal orders and seized their temples and overthrew their priesthoods as patriarchy began to dominate. Please, Hazel, do get in contact with me. I really need to connect with you. So I hear you. I hope you hear how this energy started to transform and shift, you know, from this understanding of these Sybils, these prophets. And now as patriarchy came in, these women became demonized and overthrown. So in their jealousy, hatred, and rebellion of her divine authority, the Levitical Jews elevated their original minor deity, Jehovah, as an insult to her. Together, Jehovah and his patriarchal clan usurped her sacerdotal and secular power, and from that moment on, they have worn it as their own. They did not create a new logos, they simply corrupted and repackaged the original as laid forth by the divine African mother. All right. To conceal their crimes, they destroyed and defiled her name and all of her temples. They murdered and accused her prophetesses and prophets of heresy and witchcraft and disguised her sacred rites and divine legacy as their own. This trend of random destruction, they continued so that the world would never again know or honor her as their divine African mother. Since their unauthorized acquisition of her divine authority, there has been little peace in the world. Because they have demonized the voice of her prophetesses and continue to enslave and oppress her prophets and people, there has been no divine prophecy. All that remains are hopeless corruptions of her original logos and weak imitators, says here such as Nostradamus, of her divine prophetic style, a style originally developed by the SYBILS and those of her sacred priestesshoods. The Jews, and I'm going to read this because it is written in the book, the Jews whom after the 5th century BCE could neither speak nor understand Hebrew, nor the ancient esoteric philosophy of Mami, attempted to decipher the original cuneiform tablets of the black Canaanites that predate the Hebrew language. Their crude translations deliberately corrupted many of the ancient names of the black goddesses and changed the original esoteric meaning of their prophecies to what exists now in the Torah and in the Pentateuch. As I said, do your research. These now corrupted and worn scriptures, doctrines, mass-produced and distributed now in the Judeo-Christian Bible have now been the cause of untold human suffering, massive spiritual ignorance, spiritual suffering, devastating wars, and this was especially the case between the rebellious sons of the patriarchal Afro-Pharaonic orders, who themselves were overthrown and robbed of their secular hegemony by their illegitimate offsprings, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Though all latecomers into their very ancient and divine epic, their holy wars, claiming original ownership of the black goddess legacy, are centuries old and are all that is allowed to remain within human memory. They had to basically go across the world, bringing war to wipe out and bring forth their discourse, this truth that they wanted the whole world to subscribe to. Ignorant of the original logos established by the divine African mother, their present struggles to maintain the corrupted version, which favours an exclusive, currently Euro-masculine patriarchal predominance, are nothing more than a continuation of a centuries-old battle over which patriarchal sons should control and reign over the sacerdotal power stolen from her. The most coveted prize inherent within their secular authority are the spoils of her vast empire of land and mineral resources, replete with human, meaning us, the slaves, carefully programmed vessels to exploit. This sacred empire, once bequeathed to the masses, is now controlled by those who have benefited from her suspicious absence from human worship as Mami, and the continual subjugation and degradation of the people who had known and have honored her sacred rites and religious customs for centuries, rooted in what are known today as African traditional and diasporan religions. All right, so the information is there, people. Please do your research. If you want to come to my workshop on Saturday, you can learn so much more, and I can tell you a bit more about my Mami priestess initiation that's taking place in July. Yes, family. So I've taken a break from that. We are listening to the news and views. So yeah, I mean, what do you think about the information that I have shared? What do you think about it? How does it make you feel? What does it bring up for you? All of you that's watching right now, I'm asking you to join in and share this with me. Paul said, on a spiritual, higher intelligence, higher heart note, why do you feel or think that change occurred in the relationship between man and woman? Everything is experience. One second. Greetings. Oh gosh. Oh. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Oh, Shay. Oh, thank you. I can feel it in you. I can feel the spirit in you. Oh, bless you. Yeah. Yes, I. It's not. It's not. It is a fight. A shame. No. Oh. Yeah. Oh, bless you. Oh, thank you. Okay. That's shame. Thank you, Mama. What's your name, Ma? Oh yes. Okay. Can I store your number, and I can keep in touch with you. Okay. No problem. Okay. Okay. Yeah. No. Yeah. Exactly, the conditioning, and they don't even know that they're doing it to us. They think they're keeping us safe, but they're really not. Yeah. Ashe. You will. Everlasting life. Listen. Oh, thank you. Listen. The Most High rise me up this morning to spread some joy, so. Yeah. Yes, Mama. What's your number, Mama? What's your contact number? Okay. No, that's fine. Yeah, definitely. You have to provide the foundation. But it's an online course. So what I can do is I can send it. Yes, yeah, online. Yeah, so I can send it to you. And there's a replay as well. So you don't have to worry about that. And then we've got... Oh, happy birthday! Exactly. Thank you, Mama. Thank you. 077. Yep. 48. 97. Okay, Mama. I will send you a message afterwards with the details for the event. Yeah. Yes. Marcia, I will give thanks. Yes. Okay. Ashe. Technical support, 15% off that's the mothers. Yes, Ma is the mothers, and it also is like Mary. So you would have been one of the, yeah, if you think about it, one of the priestesses, one of the nurturers. Yeah. Well, oh, bless you, Mama. All right, well, I'm going to go back on, but I appreciate you. Thank you so much, because you've given me back some energy and some chi, so thank you very much. All right, then, Ma, you take care. Thank you. Ashe. Thank you, Mama. I appreciate you so much. Thank you. Bye. Oma. That was breathtaking. That was a lady who's been listening to the show, and just her energy alone, her voice, she's like, thank you so much, you know, thank you so much. This is what I needed to hear, you know. I was a child and I could see, and you know, it's just so much coming out, and you don't realize how important it is for you to speak your truth and to do what ignites you. And sometimes you think, oh my god, this information is conflicting, or no one's going to believe me, or whatever. But your journey is your own, right? There's so many other people that really need to hear what it is that you've got to share, what it is that you've got to give, what it is that you've got to put out there, you know. And one thing she said was, yes, you know, I listen to you, and you're a young woman, and I'm listening to you as a young woman. And sometimes I think to myself, but she's young. But then I realize it's written out of the babes and sucklings. Young body, ancient soul, right? We have to tap into that soul wisdom that is available to us. We've all come here to do great works. And when each of us can stand in our truth of what it is that, you know, inspires and ignites us, then we step into our purpose. That's where we really step into our purpose. And our soul tribe, those who are meant to see us, will see us, and they will hear what they need to hear, and receive what they need to receive from us. All right. Because I was on the phone, I've got to try and get my music together to make sure that it's all in sync. Please do put your comments in below. Let me know what you've thought about the information so far that I've been sharing about this plagiarization of, you know, the Bible and things like that. What is your experience? Just give me 1 second, family. What song do I want? Greetings, family. This is Amenti the Awakener, Amenti the Oracle, joining you live and direct on Omega FM Radio 104.1, and also on the internet, omegafmradio.co.uk. I want to also thank all of my people who are listening. Thank you to sister who just called and just gave me so much chi. You know, and thanksgiving and gratitude for the information that's being shared. You know, so many of our people want to speak. They want to speak up. You know, you lot are the custodians of the stories. You know, your experiences count. And so, I'm just thankful for her sharing with me how she felt about what she received from what's being shared. And it's powerful because it allows me to step even further into my purpose. We all have insecurities. We all have fears. We all have been through the journey, but we have to tune into what inspires us and what empowers us. And this is what inspires and empowers me. I know I came here into this melanated body for a reason. I knew that I was awake for a reason. When I was younger, and I used to have, as I said to you, God was my only true voice. Like, you see, when you have the voice in your head, that's God for me. There was no separation. They're like, even God showed me who my parents were. And when they were doing things that I couldn't understand, it was God that told me, you know, brought understanding to what it was that was happening. So that connection for me can never be broken. And I always, when one of the guidance that God showed me when I was a child was that I was the physical, the feminine aspect of the creator that had chosen to come here in the flesh to wake up humanity. And first I had to be asleep. First I had to just nurture them and support them. And then when they awoken, I could awake, right? And that's what I remembered from being a child. And so for me, I know that I've chosen to come here to be in this particular vessel, in this particular body, you know, and emanate in this particular frequency with this particular consciousness to be a part of the awakening. I know that for a fact. You know, I used to see myself as an elder when I was a child. I used to see myself as an elder. I could see myself in my future state, surrounded by children, teaching them and nurturing them and preparing them for the future. I know that that's what it is that I'm here to do. So that's children in the past and children of the future. We have to understand that a lot of us have been taught to deny our magic and our power, especially as women, especially as Black women as well. We've been taught to deny our power. As I said, we have co-created to the status quo. Every time we gave birth to children and we conditioned them into thinking that they would have to bow, not bow to another, but that somebody else was seen as more important than them or had different rights to them. That's when you now start to program somebody outside of their divinity. You start to program them outside of what is true and what is divine, right? And that's what happens to us. So there has to be a process of reclaiming and reconnecting with that divinity, that divine essence. And that's what religion is supposed to do, because it deifies, you know, it personifies the God self. That's why in your most cultures, you know, the culture defines the religion. It creates the religion, so that when you now look into the images presented by that religion, it's supposed to reflect the people in their deified state. So if people are engaging in a religion which seeks to exalt their so-called oppressor, then it's going to demonize them. It's going to make them feel as if they are the inferior ones. And even when they look at their spiritual systems, even though those spiritual systems are powerful beyond measure, you know, they're going to be demonized. Like, why do we have this negative discourse around African spirituality? It's not just because of what we've done to ourselves with it, but it's also because what others have made us feel about it. But don't forget, if we look at Ethiopia was one of the countries in the world that was able to fight off invasions of the colonizers, right? How did they do that? They didn't do it by just sitting down and protesting and writing. I'm not saying that that's not effective. What I'm saying is that they utilize spiritual power. Uganda was somewhere that I went to last year. Was it last year or the year before? For my initiation into the order of Sekhmet, order of Nyabingi. Right? As the mother goddess, as the embodiment of the mother goddess, that's what I went there to go and to do, to step into that power. And part of my initiation, I was met by the spirit of Mahamuza. And Mahamuza represents that she basically was a warrior queen, a warrior who helped to liberate people in Uganda against the oppression of the white man. She is the one that put down the teachings that the order of Nyabingi follow in terms of how to live in nature, how to eat idol food, how to fight, and all of these things. It came from this uprising of her. When you look at the Dahomey empires, you look at the women, the Dahomey women who were the female warriors, who were the protectors, you know? And so you can see that in our history, this information is there, but it's been vilified. Why? Because the oppressors could not fight against us in our empowered state. It was only when things like, you know, when Muhammuza, they started to revolt, when people started to revolt, and they revolted with magic, spiritual power, that's when they started to bring out these witchcraft laws, now starting to say that, oh, you can't practice witchcraft because it's against Christ and all of this crap and all of this stuff. That was the beginning of the destabilization of our power source, of our connection to the source. We are the melanated beings, because that melanin is the same thing that is in the universe that makes the stars and the cosmos. When we sit in our center and we connect to the heavens and we have our hair and our locks connecting to the heavens, and we're sitting on the earth and we're chanting and praying and cultivating and creating energy, that's a very powerful force. Yeah. And if that energy, that being hasn't mastered themselves, that energy can be used in a very destructive way. Yeah. But that choice is down to you, how you use that energy. But the energy is yours. So the witchcraft laws and the demonization of African spirituality was for the benefit of the oppressor. It wasn't for the benefit of the oppressed. And the oppressed then started to utilize it only once it was repackaged back to them. Only once they had fallen into their fallen state and could no longer be coming from their God self. So they would utilize it for fallen things. Like, as I said, to get back your man or to do this to somebody else. Like, really? You've been from gods to now. Okay, but this is the process that took place. This is why, you know, it became such a hotbed for negativity and spirituality. Like, even at the weekend, actually, I had a very interesting experience. And I'm very aware of myself spiritually, right? And all different dimensions of myself, all of my different soul aspects, right? And I had been going through a lot of clearing because we are still going through an eclipse portal, an eclipse period. And I had a interaction on, I think it was last week, where I just felt so heavy. My energy was just feeling so heavy. I was feeling so tired, right? And I did a clearing on myself, and I could feel myself getting clear, but I could just feel this heavy kind of gunk on my crown chakra, on my head, over my third eye. And every time I tried to connect with my higher self, I could feel this gunk. I could feel this energy. And I knew that it felt like it was something that was ready to be released, but it also felt like part of me, right? And so I had to connect with one of my other sisters, one of my Caucasian sisters, actually, because you need different balances of energy in order to shift things, right? And we went into my consciousness. I went into my consciousness and saw, and it showed her, saw a past life that I'd had in the 1800s. And in that lifetime, I was a very spiritual woman, very powerful spiritual woman. And I was standing outside of this house. But in this picture, I had a I was using a sword like Excalibur, but this sword had a skull on top of it. And just the energy of it was very, very heavy, right? Very heavy. And so we kind of just investigated that life to try and figure out what was the energy of that life. Like, why does this energy feel so heavy? And basically, what it was that in that life, I was a spiritual woman. And a spiritual woman, and I had the ability to utilize all different types of spirituality. It didn't matter. I was able to do everything. And at that time, it was the Bible Belt. It was the time of, you know, slavery and oppression and coming out of that. And I was told I wasn't allowed to practice any other spirituality. I only had to practice the spirituality for the blacks, the spirituality for the oppressed, and that was voodoo at the time. And I fought against wanting to practice spirituality in my own way. And I was persecuted by my own community. So then I thought, you know what, frigate. And I was a black woman at that time. I thought, I'm just going to be the best that I can be then. And I was the best in that lifetime. But I had co-created a reality subconsciously where I had gone against what I wanted to do and transformed that energy. But at the time, that energy was quite dark because we were in our fallen state. It was dark. And so what I was feeling was the residuals of that energy. When I tell you, I was trying to pull it because it just felt so heavy. It felt so heavy because it was energy that needed to be transformed. We are everything. And because we had fallen, we had to utilize the energies that were available to us at that time to raise ourselves. But we chose to use it to bring ourselves even more down where we should have been working together collectively. And so some of that karma had to be cleared for me to even move even further into my God self. So it's like we have to also understand our history and clean it up so that we know how to move forward in the future. We can't be afraid of the awakening of our powers just because we haven't dealt with our inner shadows, because it's the inner shadows that conjures demons and connects with demonic forces. You have to have a darkness inside of you that you're willing to invest in and cultivate to be able to work with those kind of energies. I don't have time for that. I just don't. And love is the most powerful force in the universe anyway. So the point I'm trying to make is that we have deliberately gone through the demonization of our spiritual practices, and then we've also demonized ourselves and each other with them. So in order for us to move forward, we have to be willing to accept that. We have to be willing to take a journey of self-mastery, cultivating the source within, so that we're not utilizing our magic and our gifts, because it's magic is not like, no, you know, using a magic wand and boom, it doesn't work like that. It's your energy, it's magnetic energy. It's learning how to utilize to work within the laws of the universe to manifest what it is and create what it is that you need, and not just for yourself, for all of humanity, for others as well. Ooh, greetings. Somebody just popped in on my live called Megan Quashy, and my surname is Quashy. So greetings, ancestral sister, to you. You know, so and especially at this time where we're seeing this resurgence of people getting into spiritual practices, spirituality, you can still feel that energy of the unresolved inner shadow, the unresolved inner conflict, the unresolved, you know, nasties. Because if when you resolve all of that stuff, you don't want to spend time hexing people or sending out negativity to try and control people. Like when this whole pandemic was happening, I was thinking to myself, where's all the spiritualists? You know, where's all these people? Where were all the spiritualists? Why are we not coming together and doing rituals that are going to actually help the planet? You know, instead, everybody was like, oh, I'm going to lower my prices for you to work with me. It makes no sense. This is where we're actually meant to do the real work. The real work, you know. But then at the same time, Mother Nature is always doing what she needs to do. So as much as we're always saying, oh, we want to bring healing to the planet, we don't, the planet doesn't need healing. Like Mother Earth does not need any support to do what she's doing. Like, even though it seems like it's destructive, even though it seems like it's chaotic, it's exactly what needs to take place. Exactly. So your best position is to be operating from within, you know, and controlling that inner world. Okay. All right, friends and family. So I pray that was insightful. I'm sure it was. I was going to play a song, but I have to wait for my computer to restart itself. This stuff that I'm speaking to you about, this information I'm speaking to you about, is not just book information. This is stuff that I've experienced my own self. Like some of these things I'm reading from my journals, you know, some of my journals that I'm reading from communications that I've had with my spirit, the ancestral mothers, different aspects of soul consciousness and the source. And so this is how we reignite our God self, by connecting with the God self within, by acknowledging that inside of us is this infinite pool of resources and information, right? And that we become God by embodying our God consciousness and seeking to go within. So that's what spirit is telling me. Now, whilst my computer is loading up, my spirit is guiding me. Sorry. To just pick a card from the Divine Feminine pack. Not sure why. I didn't actually bring this pack for this. But my spirit is saying to me to draw some energy. Giving thanks to everybody that's tuning in on Facebook. Gebra says, talk the things, Empress. Unk spirit, thanks for further confirming. Yeah, the truth shall be revealed. We're in a time of revelations. Linda says, speak. Yes, give thanks, sis. I am speaking. Greetings to Kirsty, who's been joining us, who has an amazing group online for helping mumpreneurs to step up and step out in their business. Greetings, Karen. Karen Wofford says, you're doing great. Only real truth. You are manifesting. Those who harm are trying. True quartz. Ashe, give thanks. Linda says, go within, clearing out the dross and re-emerging, stepping into my sovereignty and knowing myself, knowing my roots, bringing back divine balance as it was in the beginning. Ashe, I see, I think it's pronounced Isis Couture. She said, it makes so much sense. The black woman is still one of the most disrespected members of society, of the world, girl. Yes, but she knows her power, you know, she knows. How do we change this narrative and reclaim our order? We have to embody our truth. We have to walk in our magic and majesty. We have to remember who we are and embody that. Because even when people ask me that, when it comes to things like oppression and slavery and all these things, right? How do we change it? You change it by being the change. That's how you change it. You change it by becoming the change. You don't ask the oppressor to see you. You see yourself. When someone sees you in your power, then the whole thing changes. You don't have to say anything. You know, once you stand and embody a certain power, the whole world responds to you differently. You're no longer asking for them to see you. You're being you. So they have no choice but to see you. So that's the way that I believe that we change it, by being the best version of ourselves and not allowing ourselves to become too attached to the story. Everything is teaching us. So it's a story. You know, this suit that you're wearing is a suit that you put on to come and have this experience, but you're not the experience. And that's what we need to understand. That's what soul consciousness is. It's being able to live from that place where you understand that you are not the story. All right? So the divine feminine energies that have come up today. I love these cards, but I use them for myself, and I'm also creating a pack which is for melanated people, a celebration of the black goddess. But one of the cards that came up is Catherine Labour. And the reason why I like these cards is just loads of different feminine spiritual figures, so to speak. And you can learn about the different spiritual figures in all of the different cultures of the whole world culture through these cards. And that's what I like about them. It's got some really good stories to help you to just tune into that divine feminine authority spirit, that spirit and all of the qualities that the divine feminine has, right? So the first woman, she's the patroness of miraculous healing. The patroness of miraculous healing. And she says, I'm ready to heal. Ha! Simple. I am ready to heal and I'm worthy of the miracles meant for me. Affirmation for you, black woman. For you, woman, I am ready to heal and I'm worthy of the miracles meant for me. Miracles. And remember in the card reading that we had at the beginning, it said expect miracles. Expect miracles. We are superhuman, superhero beings. Like, you know, Storm from the X-Men, that's me. Ever since I was a child, I was able to control the weather with my emotions and with my thoughts. You know, who are you? Which X-Men are you? What superpower do you have to contribute to the world? See yourself in your divine state. The next card that came out is Mirabai, and she is the saint of true freedom. True freedom. Love is what sets me free, and I'm married to my own soul. And the reason why I like this card so much is because this is something that I had to learn. I had to learn that I'm not married to the unit. I'm not married to other people. I'm not married to other people's perceptions of me or whatever status quos that they want to have or their comfortability. I'm married to my purpose. I have to honor and love the soul in me. I have to honor the truth that's in me, right? And the other side of this is that love is what sets you free. Fear, anger, hate, jealousy, limitation, all of those things entrap you and suppress you and put you in a box. Love is what sets you free. It allows you to see yourself and it allows you to see others. So we appreciate that guidance. And then the last card that came from the Divine Feminine is Ariadne. And I think it's kind of like a Scottish kind of Irish kind of word, Celtic word. And she is the mistress of the labyrinth, right? The labyrinth. And the card says, my soul knows the way. I love that. My soul knows the way. Follow your spirit. Follow your soul. Follow the dancing and winding path. And it says, the only way out is through. The only way out is through. And that kind of helps me. I mean, that depicts where we're at right now, doesn't it? The only way out is through. We've got to go through it. We've got to go through the pain. We've got to go through the fire. We've got to go through it all in order to transform it, in order to bring it to its highest state. All right, so... Giving thanks. All right, so just checking up on some of these comments. Somebody said, all of this happened for a reason. All of these circumstances happened due to some form of source consciousness orchestration. Source implanted all feelings, all internal communication. There must be a very magical, necessary reason behind all of this. It definitely is. Men and women, all of us are just extensions, avatars for sources, energy, consciousness. So why did it want this to occur? Everything, I mean, okay, so don't forget, once a creation is created and put out there, the nature of creation is that it's allowed to follow its path, right? Sometimes something that's created ends up creating destruction and becomes a disruption. And it's a big story in terms of the story of the universe and the story of the energies that function in the universe. But many of us that are here right now are definitely part of a big plan and an agenda, you know, connected to Tiamat and Nibiru and what took place on the previous Earth, because this is a new Earth that we're on. As much as you think it's the Earth, the only Earth, no. There was an Earth before this and it was called Tiamat. And so... I don't want to go too deep into that part of the story. But basically what I'm saying is, yes, everything is divinely orchestrated. Everything is divine. Not everybody is an avatar. We are, because the Avatar movie made you think that everybody that wears a suit, everyone who jumps into a human body is an avatar. But no, that is not an avatar. An avatar is a high dimensional, high vibrational being that chooses to come into this body to be a part of the cataclysm, like to be a part of change. Like the archetype of Jesus is an avatar. Like you know, when the Dalai Lamas, they are avatars. You know, that even a guru isn't someone who knows that they're a guru until, well, really, what I want to say about that is that people have a false conception about gurus and avatars, that they know who they are and they walk around this world being perfect and in their enlightened guru state. No, an avatar and a guru, what makes them that is that they go through the same lessons that everyone else goes through, sometimes on a deeper level, because the lessons, that the energy that they gain and the information that they gain from going through those traumatic experiences gives them the substance that they can now teach other people to help them and be an example to others of the human journey. Like even the Christ only came to teach us and go through the same thing that we went through. He died like just how we died. And I'm talking about it from a story perspective. I look at it all as archetypes, right? So we have to understand that nature and that everything is teaching us. I blatantly felt like I just jumped out of the matrix and jumped right back. So yeah, I've just lost my train of thought there, but I'm just gonna let it be what it is. So I'm gonna play a song. Wow, the universe just grabbed something right out of my head, but it is what it is. So I'm gonna play this song, and I think I'm just gonna continue playing Damian Marley and Nas, Distant Relatives, because it just seems like that's the vibration right now. So this one is called Leaders. Greetings, family. So I'm going to rewind that one. This one is for all of the leaders. It's time to activate that leadership spirit in you. If you have a vision, let's go. Let's be about that change. Greetings, family. Thank you, everybody, for still being with me. Greetings, Ryan. Sending you much, much love. Isis says, your energy is so refreshing. You helped me grow through this quarantine. Thank you. Thank you, sis. You know, I'm growing too through this quarantine. I'm stepping up and stepping out more and realizing that I do have something to share in this world, you know. I see myself. For a long time, I allowed myself to be hidden. For a long time, I even allowed people in my own community to make me feel like I wasn't good enough, like I was a weirdo, like there's something wrong with me. Sometimes even the people that you've come here to save won't accept you. That's just the nature of this journey and this story, right? Give me a moment. Hello? Oh, thank you, sister. Oh, from Grenada. Yes. Yes. Yes, you did. Oh, I'm so good. How are you? Oh, gosh. Yes, girl, because you're meant to be here, so. Yes. Oh, of course. Yes, we must. Oh, good. I'm sending you so much love. Oh, so nice to hear from you. Oh, bless you. Where are you in Grenada now? Oh, can you send me your number? Can you text it to me, please? Yeah? Yeah. Right, yeah, build the foundation and then the rest will happen. Oh, I love you, thank you. Bless your spirit, I love you very much. Please make sure you send me the number, mama, please. Oh, well. Oh, good. That's what we need. You need to feel the vibration. Yes. Exactly. You see? Because they need to be home. Yes, definitely has to be changed. It's time. Definitely. Exactly. Yes. Everything is for a reason. It's going good. I've got an online course for it as well now. So send me, that's why I want you to send me the details and then I can send you the course. An online course that goes with the book. Yeah. So it can go with it. Ashe, thank you. Yes, please, send me your number because I'm going to go back on now. All right then, Mama. Thank you. Love you too. Bye. Oh my goodness. Now, is she gone? Oh, that sister called all the way from Grenada. Grenada, right? And she's literally vibrating. She's like, oh my god, like this edit, the information that you're sharing, I can feel it in my body, I can feel it in my, you know, she's like, I'm vibrating, like literally the truth when it resonates, you know. A people can only be oppressed when they don't know themselves, when they've been taught to hate themselves, right? Greetings, family. This is Amenti, the Awakener, Amenti, the Oracle. I was just having a beautiful conversation with a woman. Thank you for calling. And she was just sharing with me, you know, how this information is resonating with her, how it's just making her vibrate in her being, in her spirit. And, you know, this is what it's about. You know, when you feel the truth, when you hear the truth, it resonates within you. And are people who know themselves, are people who know who they are, they can never be suppressed. And we can't elevate one aspect of the people and demonize, you know, the rest of the culture. For a long time, us women, black women, we have felt demonized. And yes, I do love our black kings and our black brothers. And yes, I do know that divine balance, divine order, divine harmony is what's going to take us, you know, to the next stage. But we still have to acknowledge. We so have to acknowledge. You know, the divine feminines. We do have to acknowledge the black woman. We have to acknowledge. I wrote a poem. No, I didn't write a poem. I had a dream, a vision. I think it was 2 days ago. And I was visited by a mammy. Like, one of those black women in slavery times. The big, you know, the big mama who came and spoke to me. And she shared her story with me. And the story that she shared with me was about, 1441 and 41% on my laptop. It's 555. 5 is the number of great change. So I just want to acknowledge that. Give thanks. Where was I at? Sorry, the 555 just went bloop in my mind. I think I might have to come back to that. What was I actually saying? Anyway, it's gone out of my mind for now. It will come back. What I'm going to do right now is I am going to play another song and then I will be back, and I'm sure that it would have jumped back into my head by then. Okay? I'm sure. Greetings, people. Oh, I was talking about the woman in Grenada. That's what I was talking about. Hey, Carleen. Hope you're well. Okay, so Paul says, my mom experienced, I was talking about the black woman and the oppression of the black woman. I get it. All right, so my mom experienced the whole night of Olympics on TV in 2012 and then told my dad, and then he said it can't be as it's on live in a few days' time. My mom and dad then both went on to watch it 2 days later, and my mom commenting every single moment for the next 2 hours before it happened. Therefore, it got me realizing that the future has already happened. It has already happened. Then is that the creator, the source of creator at work, or the creator's creations? Therefore, source, Therefore, Source must have everything all wrapped up all along. So again, I ask, what is it Source is wanting us to learn, as the nature of itself is it always is and always has been past. So if we are not creating or changing anything, then we must be simply going along. There's no such thing as going along. We are experiencing. We are experiencing the creations that we've already created. Like, even our life is an experience of that which is already created, because you've written the plan and the purpose before you came here. You already wrote out the purpose. You already wrote out the journey. You just decided to forget that amnesia comes from the fall. Because if you write a story and then in that story, let's say, for example, you write that you're going to kill somebody, and that's for you to learn the lesson of what it's like to take your life, then you're not going to want to remember that, are you? Otherwise, you wouldn't do it. So as much as, yes, it's already been written, it's the new experience for the fact that you're experiencing it. I love the way God speaks through me. Ashe. Greetings to Jesse. Hope you're well. Oh, the dream of the mama. Thank you, Udine. Thank you, thank you. And that's why I was going to my computer, so I could find the poem that I wrote based on what she had to say. Let's see. Instagram. Amenti. Thank you, Udine. Thank you, Carleen, as well. Everyone, I can only now see where you're reminding me of what it was I was saying. That's so funny. I'm gonna get into it just after. So I've answered that, Paul. Ryan says, much love to you, sister. Blessed to you, shining your fire and being that beacon. Yeah, we all gotta do what we gotta do, hey? Where's the poem? There it is. Don't you hate technology sometimes? Thanks for your input and reply, much appreciated. Oh, you're welcome. It came from spirit, came from the source, so we're gonna receive it for what it is. Wanna be skanking? You got Facebook on? No, Instagram. You know, have you got Instagram? Can I go on your Instagram? I just need to get my poem. Hello, so I can read it to the people. Just go on Instagram and then go to Amenti the Awakener. Please. Greetings, greetings, family. That was Chronics. And it's funny because since I've been back on the radio this year, I haven't played him very much. And last year, he was just like everything to me. So I want to give thanks. To Chronics for that, their vibration. Actually, I might play another one of his to celebrate us a bit more after the break, or after I finish speaking. So thank you to everyone on my Facebook who was reminding me of what it is that I forgot. Or not even what forgot, but yeah, something happened. So, and what it was that I was talking about was the dream that I was having and the mammy that came in my dream. And the mammy represents the women in who, you know, the mother in slavery who basically would have to feed and nourish the slave master's children. And thank you. When she came into my dream, thank you. She came into my dream, and this was like just at the beginning of this uprising in terms of this awakening with regards to white privilege and white fragility and all these things, right? And me, as I said, I wasn't sure how to respond, because I've had my own experiences on both sides of the fence, and I've chosen to always see things from a soul perspective for that reason, you know. But I wanted to give, what did I want to do? I basically just had to receive the story that it was that she gave. And yeah, it was quite poignant. But I'm trying to get this up, so one second. Can you just check this? Yeah, she was basically communicating a story. And a side of the story that we hadn't seen before. And in my research of what it was that she had said to me, I started to find some pictures, and one of the pictures, I posted it up on my page, and it was a picture of a black woman who had her breasts out and she was feeding her baby, but one of the babies was a white baby, and one of the babies was a black baby, and it says on the picture that the woman, the black woman who was feeding these babies, she would have to like keep one of her breasts for the white baby only, right? That she was not allowed to feed her baby from that breast, and that if she did feed her child from that breast, she could be whipped or she could be hurt, you know. And so sometimes even when her own baby wanted to feed, she would have to reject her own child in order to feed the slave master's child. And that takes like a certain kind of love, right? A certain kind of strength, a certain kind of power to do that, right? But then also the residuals of that is feelings of abandonment, feelings of rejection for the children. And but her when she was speaking to me in my dream, she was showing me a difference. She was showing me that for her, it wasn't about separation. She knew that both of these children were her children, but she knew that one day one child would have to stand up for the other. One child would have to fight for the other to be seen. And so the love that she gave to them both would be the love that would sustain to that time. And it was a very, very powerful dream. And so she spoke to me, and there was something that she wanted to share. And so I just felt inspired in this time to share it, because it also shows the strength that we have, you know, as people. This is about us being one human family. But if you have any family and the mother is not appreciated, the mother is looking all downtrodden, she's looking like, you know, God knows what, then the family doesn't come off looking very well. You're not looking after your mother. You're not looking after the foundation. You're not honoring that from which you came, right? So, yeah, I'm going to read the poem a bit. And, I'm just going to read it. So, in my dreams, I was visited by an ancient woman from our past. Her name was Mami. And she had a message she wanted to share and a reminder. Hear her speak. Do you remember me? Do you remember that I used to sing to you? I would hold you to my breasts and feed you nourishment. I wanted the best for you. Even though I knew the stock from which you came, I knew the ancestry that was running through your veins, and I also knew that what flowed through me was the antidote for all the pain. I would sing to you. As I rocked you to sleep, sometimes you would get upset when my own child wanted to feed. You were so excited by our daily meats, you couldn't wait to grab my breast so that you could eat. The pain runs deep. At time, I even rejected my own, turned away from my own seed, for to nourish you was to nourish the future and the hope of all of my dreams of freedom. I knew one day you would grow and be in a position to lead, so I'm asking you now to do what is right, not for me, but for humanity. See what you have become and ask yourself how it can be that we are anything separate when from my breasts you feed. My DNA is within you. Your DNA holds my ancestry. You are no longer you anymore. Within every cell of you is me. For many generations, me and my sisters nurtured your seeds. And now it's time for you to return the blessings back to me. Let your soul empower you to speak up for your brother and sisters. No longer can you allow the illusion that you are more powerful than the other, because the light in you is the light in me too. And now is the time to reveal the truth about who my children really are. God's in the unseen. The time is now to redefine all that once was. But know, my child, know that when the battle is won, know that it was fought on a foundation of love. Do you remember me now? Does your soul remember my voice? In you I planted seeds of hope. What you do now, that is your choice. And to my royal children who felt abandonment and shame, know we never rejected you. Know the power from which you came. This time is yours for the taking. And as the tables turn, please remember to be graceful. And remember all that you have learned. For in truth, there is no separation. There is only love. So let your love and power shine through the darkest space. Give your pain a voice. And then rise like the dove, the black dove that you are, rise, my babies, rise and shine. And yeah, that for me, when I first received it, it was not painful, but I could feel it in my body. I could feel it in my being. But I also understood the level of strength and ingenuity that it would take for someone to think in that way. You can't control the situation that you're in right now, but you can invest in the future of bettering that situation. So, yeah, I really appreciated receiving that. And I shared it on my page, and I got so much feedback from people. I got so much feedback. I had a message from one woman as well. And she basically is a Caucasian sister, and she took it to her meditation. She went into her meditation about it, and she asked her God, she asked her spirit, you know, what is it? Why is it like this? And her spirit basically told her, look, your ancestors knew how powerful that they were going to be, and they didn't want them to overpower their next generation. So it was in their best interest to teach you how to see yourself as separate and better, and for them to feel as if they were, you know, and to create conditions for those children to make them feel that they are not who they are. So we have to understand, right? This is not a black versus white. This is not a me versus you. This is a conditioning, an agenda, a past experience that still has wounds and still has an effect on us now. And we are the, you know, all of us are the children. We are the hopes and dreams. We are the tears of our ancestors, the babies that were fed on the mammies. Those are the people that we're connecting with and communicating with now. So we can't tar everyone with the same brush, right? We have to understand. And as I go back to Revelations, it says you will not know your brother or sister from the color of their skin, nor from the things that you subscribe to. Because I have many people that are my color, and not all of them are my friends. Not all of them see me. Like, it's got nothing to do with that, but it has got everything to do with understanding where the imbalance has been, and where we need to change the discourse, and where we need to release from the subconscious co-creation, that the subconscious agreements that we have made to either live in an inferior or superior mindset. We've chosen that. And whether it's those who came before us that chose it and we became conditioned into it, we can choose now differently. We can choose now differently. And that means re-empowering ourselves. This is not about us hitting other people over the head with our knowledge and our facts and our evidence. Because as I said, when you become that which you are, it emanates from you. You don't have to tell anybody anything. People know you when you walk in the room and you're divine, because it emanates from you and you embody that truth. So before we go to another song before the break, and then I'm going to be done, I'm going to read one of the other channelings that I received this week. And this channeling was from the spirit of Mama Ixchel. Ixchel is an ancient Aztecian, Mesopotamian, South American kind of energy goddess, a mother goddess, representing the lunar energies, representing the rainbow energies as well. And the rainbow energies represent light. It represents all of the frequencies of light. Lucifer is the light bearer, meaning that he has dominion over the light realms, the realms that we can see. That doesn't mean that, you know, well, that's the discourse that we're taught. So I'm just showing you that light spectrum of rainbow represents the world manifest, the material world manifest. So Mama Ixchel has something to say, and so I shared this on my page. Somebody's calling me, but not right now. All right, so... And this was her way of helping us to understand what it is that's happening right now, okay? Mama Ixchel says, we are in the birthing canal, crowning and moving through the ring of fire. All who have journeyed through the process of birthing life know too well the focus that is required. You will be tested. You may scream in pain and you may feel like you want to die, but you know that you cannot and will not. You know that on the other side of all that you are, you may feel like you want to die, but you know that you cannot and will not. You know that on the other side of all that you fear is the gift of a new life, of love like you have never known before, and the death of the old, to become something new, not just to this new life, but also to become somebody new to you. You will never be the same, but will have gained so much more in return. A new title you will have earned, and a position gifted to the faithful, the trusting, the willing, We are birthing. And at whatever stage that this message finds you, meets you, know that your next stage will be your best yet. Take the time to burn away what no longer serves you before it decays. And dare to dream your wildest dreams and watch them manifest in reality through the process of alchemy and transformation, transmutation. Your fears will fade. Your light will be reborn and you will rise again. We will rise again, triumphant and enjoying the new life that awaits us all. Heaven or hell is a mind state that can be felt deeply. Nurture and protect your mind. Take time to go inside and feel for the truth. Choose wisely. Surrender to the process of becoming your greatest version of self. The time is now. Let the jaguar medicine rip through your fears and enlighten you. You are powerful beyond measure. Just breathe and let it flow. And so that was the message from Mama. Everything is in divine order. Everything is in divine alignment. It is what it is. Get yourself information. Use the information and get yourself into a position that is best for you and best supports your dreams, your goals, your visions. Okay, so we are winding down and coming to the end of the show for today. I really want to thank everybody who has been tuning in, who's been giving their comments. Linda says, have to go. Love you, my sister. Thank you. Change can be messy. Definitely can be messy. Paul says, I love you, sister, and I'm so proud of you being here now, speaking love for humanity. I'm thankful because I'm proud of myself. Every day I resist and fight my own demons that say, okay, well, you know, who wants to hear this? You know, do people believe you? Do they care? So I'm thankful to myself for not standing in my own way. And I'm thankful to you for reflecting and receiving me in that way. Thank you. Greetings to Patrina at the Venture Center, doing some amazing stuff there to keep the community going. I've been helping them to do food banks and also they've been doing a lot of things over there as well. So big up to you, Patrina, and everyone down at the Venture Center. Giving thanks to everybody on my Facebook. I'm just checking if there's any comments that I need to read out. Your energy is so refreshing. I really appreciate you. All right. The history needs to come out. A tree cannot be a tree without its roots. Yes, Queen. Very, very, very important. All right, Soul Family. So this has been Amenti the Awakener. I've had a very, very good day. And a good time communicating with you all. If you would like to join me for the workshop, the online workshop that is taking place this Saturday, then please do send me a text on 07455617892. That's 07455617892. And we will also be doing, as I said, two programs, two courses, one which is a self-development course for women to help awaken their magic and majesty, do some of this soul work, healing, some of this deep shadow work and stuff like that. And then for those who want to follow the priestess path, who those who are ready to awaken their healer, to awaken their inner divine leader, to step into their divine feminine power and authority, to gain this information to ensure that we never forget again. You know, our children need to know their divine knowledge and history and be born into their royalty. So the more of us that are doing the work and walking the path and talking the talk, the more that this becomes the norm, you know, to have healers and empowerers in our community. So I want to say thank you to everyone, and I'm sending you love of the highest vibration. Have a great week. Support black businesses, support each other, support humanity, support balance, because we are in the time of Ma'at and everything is being reset and set to how it needs to be. So I shall see you all next week. Mwah! Much love.
Media Radio, 104.1 FM.
Thank you, Soul Family. I appreciate you all here on this Facebook. Thank you all for your comments. Thank you, Paul. I've been feeling you the whole way through. I'm thankful to you. Thank you to Ryan. Thank you to Akila. Thank you to Udin. Thank you to you all. I'm sending you much, much love of the highest vibration. Mwah! And have a great day. Bye.